We're truly privileged this evening to be joined by Julie Mehretu, whose extraordinary career helped to rekindle a revival of painting at the turn of this last century. Her work has been exhibited and collected by museums around the world, including the High Museum of Art, the Whitney Museum of American Art, the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum, as well as the Deutsche Guggenheim, the Detroit Institute of Arts, the Louisiana Museum in Denmark, the Museo de Arte Contemporáneo de Castillo, León, Tate Modern, the list goes on and on. For me, uncannily, Julie's work has been included in some of the most important pivotal exhibitions of her generation, including an exhibition titled Poetic Justice, which was the title of the 8th Istanbul Biennial in 2003, which is where we first met, actually. I don't know if you recall, but my partner and I met you at that time, which was a thrill for us. So from that exhibition, multiple exhibitions, fast forward to Documenta XIII, which was presented in 2012 in Kassel, Germany, where the cycle of paintings Mogamma was premiered. As I mentioned, part two of that cycle is on view upstairs in the Wheeland Skyway. And later, when you come back, of course, multiple times to see that painting, but come also to see Julie's multi-part print titled Auguries, which was commissioned by New York's Metropolitan Opera, which is on view in the lower level galleries as part of our Driscoll Prize exhibition. It feels funny to talk about you in the third person when you're sitting right here.
Sorry, I set you up.
Julie, no, that's okay. Julie was born in Addis Ababa in 1970, raised in Michigan, and attended the University Sheikh Anta Diop in Dakar, Senegal, before earning degrees at the Kalamazoo College in Kalamazoo, Michigan, and then at the Rhode Island School of Design in Providence in 97. She was a resident of the core program at the Glassell School of Art at the Museum of Fine Arts in Houston, as well as the acclaimed Artist in Residency program at the Studio Museum in Harlem in 2001. She's received numerous prizes and awards, chief among them the MacArthur Genius Award and the Berlin Prize from the American Academy in Berlin. Now, I'm not a religious person particularly, but I do believe in spirits. And they always tend to visit me in taxi cabs, it seems. And so it was this morning when I came in back into town, a lovely, beautiful spirit, the man who drove me here, I asked where he was from, and he was from Eritrea. And so I mentioned the program tonight and Julie's name. And he mentioned to me, he told me how to say your name in his language, Mehretu, yeah. And that your name means blessing. So we're doubly blessed tonight to have you here, and I welcome you. Please help me welcome Julie one more time.
Thank you, Michael.
My pleasure.
It's really a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank Michael Shapiro as well, and also Alyssa McClure and Marion Goodman Gallery for helping with this whole. But I'm very happy to have the painting here and to be here and visited the collection before, and yeah, it's great context. And,
thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. I'm going to jump right in because we have a lot to talk about.
Okay.
By the way, we have a series of images that Julie has selected that will be cycling on the screen, and we may or may not refer to them, but they're there to provide some context to what we will be talking about eventually, and that is the painting on view in the galleries. But before we get there, I came to your work a little bit late, I have to say. I first saw it in 2003 in Istanbul. I knew of it, of course, but that was the first time I had seen it in the flesh. And a colleague and friend of mine, who was a former curator of the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis, did an exhibition of your work, Drawing into Painting, and described your work, quote, perfect metaphors for the increasingly interconnected and complex character of the 21st century. And for me, that really encapsulated how your work tackles the sort of unfinished histories of the last century and those incipient histories that we anticipate or that are just beginning to unfold. So my question, I guess, is how do you do that? I mean, as in other
it's a
words...
Lot of, it's a lot of expectation on an artist.
No, no. Well, I guess my real question is, when I first saw your work in 2003, it seemed as though you had a fully formed visual language or the a fully formed set of tools in this language that has since that time evolved and grown, but it seemed that that language really did address a moment that we were all experiencing at the turn of the century.
For me, so many all of that language emerged very organically and very much in its part. I mean, there was always interested in keeping, in a sense, my way of making within the realm of abstraction. And I was interested in that because of its ability to deal with complexities without being definitive, and being able to ask an open-ended questions in a way. And then I was also interested in the history of abstraction and painting and the confrontation with a painting. And there was this form that I worked within very kind of organically and naturally and fluidly, and kind of emerged slowly. And then as I was investigating myself within that language, other elements started to enter the language, like the architectural elements or the drawing started to mimic looking like aerial views of maps and cityscapes. And so as that continued to evolve, I would ask other questions that started to come into the language based on the demands of the work, but also what kinds of investigative questions I was asking about the work. So it was a very fluid, organic evolution. And I think, you know, sometimes some pieces can have a certain resonance with a moment, and other times they stand within a different place in time. But I think that that it's just this kind of montage aspect of bringing in these various elements together to kind of cooperate in a way to have a different type of pictorial experience.
What did your work look like before 2001, while you were kind of figuring your path out from...
I think it was a lot more spare. Like in 1998, 1997, the work was very small marks that plotted and charted their ways around some kind of blank terrain. And it felt very layered. Some of the paintings had 9 layers of drawing that you could see every layer. And it was this evolution of a space, almost like looking into an anthill or something. It was like you could really plot out these. But it didn't have it mimicked a map space, but it was really on a no terrain, a blank space. And so that's one of the reasons that I started to, in Houston, bring the architectural language into the paintings and actually also make them bigger so that you had a different interaction with the picture and a physical kind of interaction with the painting.
Were there moments during your studies from 91 in Dakar to Providence?
No. The work I was doing, not at all. The work I was, I mean, what I was a very young, I mean, interests are very similar in terms of who I am, but I was working with a batik artist learning his form, really, when I was studying in Dakar. And what I was really studying there was the language and the culture and history, politics, and economics within the university there, struggling to keep up with these students who were there, who were like so fluent. So it was a very different kind of experience.
It's interesting, the university, it's named for a renowned historian and anthropologist who studied pre-colonial African cultures.
Yeah.
And so I thought that was really interesting now in the context of your career.
Well, my desire to go to the school that I went to is really because of this program they had in West Africa. And having been born in Ethiopia and raised in the States, and we went back with my family to live in Zimbabwe when my father was doing work there in 1984, which was 4 years just after the revolution and after Mugabe was really building a different future in Zimbabwe. And Mugabe at this point was the darling of the West and the darling of like the future of what could be the old Rhodesian state, what was the old Rhodesian country. So, and it was the country that could set an example in opposition to South Africa. So most of the Rhodesians who couldn't handle this change left and went down to South Africa or to Australia, and where apartheid was still very much in effect. And so, having grown up during this time from parents who lived through the process of the decolonization of most of the continent, through to their effort to build a very different future in their country, to that falling apart, and then the effort of a new development and being a very active part of an emergent new country and its development. We grew up with this very, a certain kind of, I was informed by a certain type of African internationalism that was very exciting and very kind of, very exciting and very, it's seductive in a way. And so when I was, where I really wanted to go back to West Africa, which had been, Dakar is a big part of that, is a center, if you will, in that scene, the same way that Abidjan would be, or Congo was Kinshasa was in a way for music. And so you have these places that were considered really core, Harare, Kinshasa, Addis Ababa, Nairobi, Dakar. And so I wanted to, you know, if I could be there, that's where, one of the reasons I went to the school I went to. So there's this attraction to that possibility. So, and that was him. That man was an example of that, Sheikh Abdadjo.
You mentioned music just now, and I'm skipping ahead because I know we need to talk about Mogamma, but the painting upstairs always seemed to me, when I first saw you working on them in the studio in New York, musical and the orchestral, rather. And I think of them still in that way. And you've used musical terms to describe the painting upstairs. Do you think of music? Do you think of the formation of your paintings in terms of that kind of marshalling of different systems and forces?
Yeah, I think they have very strong sonic elements to them in terms of their structure, but then also how they are composed with all these various parts. One of the best compliments I had on the work was Jason Moran, a composer, contemporary composer, wrote me after he saw the paintings in Castle, the four of them, and he took a woman back, the director of an opera that was commissioning him, or a director of some type of creative festival or something in Germany that was commissioning him to do something, and he took her in and showed her the paintings and told her, from what he told me, this is a score. That was like one of the most, you know, for me, such a high compliment, because I really think of them as participating and having a performative kind of element to them, the way that they're being made. But they have a very strong sonic element for me too. They kind of resonate in that way that you can almost hear them in ways. And so, yeah, music, and I listen to music a lot while I'm working. So it plays a big role in the work.
And time too. I mean, I'm thinking about the sort of idea of collapsing time and space in your work, but music being a durational form of art, but so is your painting.
Yeah.
In a way.
And it takes time to actually experience these paintings. They're slow experiences.
Do you think that they unfold and before your audience, or is it the other way around, where your audience is sort of drawn into the work? Is it a combination of that you desire in one's experience of the work?
They really do unfold, I think, in a bit as you participate with them as an audience. Excuse me. There's an element in the work where you can actually see the coalescence of like these marks and the architecture and these various bits, but they really come forward in your experience of them, how you experience them as you're with them. It's an individual, very subjective experience. And I'm very interested in that. Sorry.
Can I get you?
No, I just had allergies.
Sorry.
It's okay.
No, well, the overlapping, the layering of information too is something that's very important. An idea that you discuss when describing your work, you often return to the idea of the palimpsest, where you've got a surface with layers of information. Much information has been erased. Erasures are important, just as important as the sort of accretions, those things that are layered on top. And that seems to me part of what you were describing just now as well.
Yeah, I don't think of them as having been the tabula rasa, right? They're always informed by what has come before them, in terms of not just in my work, but also in terms of in their deeper, evolution within the paintings. So none of this architectural information that's in the work is
is coming from without a past. It's all referencing a very strong political, social orientation, and is being built from within that context.
Right. And the architectural elements, we were upstairs earlier and were identifying some of the different sites that are referenced in our painting, but these are sites that are architecturally like a palimpsest. Actually, you can use the word palimpsest in terms of architecture, right? Where a building demonstrates its evolution over time, different cultures or different periods of time that this building has grown or been added to. And so that these buildings demonstrate a sort of a geopolitical forces that go to shape the nature of a place or the political sort of thrust of a given place or society.
The architectural information was really interesting working on these because the Mogammas, because they each city has a very specific political history. It's either a colonial city, or like Addis Ababa really wasn't. It was a very kind of it was occupied for 5 years during the 40s, the late 30s and 40s. But it was very much a most of the other cities were colonial cities or with European cities. And the structure of the city, the information that goes into these buildings, who they were colonized by. And what creates that social political context of them participated in the hybrid nature of like, or the kind of relationship between all of them. And that to me was super interesting. How do you find in most of the European cities you would have these kind of obelisks that were actually taken from the continent, and then you see them being celebrated, and then you'd have these places within the colonial cities that were actually these kind of references to the colonizer. That were within the square. So these places that were these contradictions within social histories that were like within the because of the historic nature of the city.
References to the colonizer in terms of power structures.
The power structure.
Yeah.
But that it was always present. It's always there. So a city like Cairo, whatever historic role you see has played out there in terms of a period of time, whether it was the British or Mamluk architecture from the past, or forms of, type of emergent modernism that happened in the late 40s, 50s, 60s, with a different idea of where Africa could go, where these cities could be, to a relationship to the Beaux-Arts and the kind of evolution of that form and conversations with Paris. So you really see these informing the evolution of the city.
Have you discovered in your research how, say, a square with modern architecture, which you think of as more, utopian, progressive ideas, and then squares with architecture that's neoclassical, how these different kinds of signs or messages have turned out in terms of today, what the political reality of today, how that architecture did or did not have a role in how these sites have.
It's interesting because each building around any of these squares were built for very, very different, for their own reason. Very few times were they really thought of as facing this public plaza. I mean, you have the Mogamma in Cairo that was thought of that way, but most of the other buildings around the square were built with very different intentions. And in a way, those buildings that had that desire and intention kind of embedded in them, they actually became. They actually, in a way, became very authoritarian and operated in a way that wasn't necessarily very humanist, if you will. Not that that's not something I really care about, but that these buildings operated almost in a sense in opposition to that. So, to me, it's the contradiction that I'm interested in within those structures, and then the montage effect of time and place that are then situated in within to create this vessel of this social type of. Contain social action or social desire that you think of with a public plaza or a public square or even the idea of that type of concept. Mm-hmm. The idea that this is a place where you can actually behave and act out, let's call somebody said to me in an interview, First Amendment rights, in a way.
Yeah.
There's this construct of this place as being a vehicle for that, and it's really you know, these squares have been used in all kinds of ways, for propagandistic purposes, all the way through to horrifically, horrific public executions, and to social movement and social places where real social changes occur. So I'm interested. I was really thinking about looking at all of that and in this container of the other levels of time and place that are suggested by the architecture.
And what's your perspective and your personal perspective in terms of these histories? And I mean,
in terms of like,
is it more objective? I mean, I think there's a question we had earlier this evening about politics, and there was a wonderful little article written in a local blog describing your practice in terms of kind of a 5,000 foot aerial view of the realities of the world today, and that being an objective sort of account taking, really, and knowledge building.
I think it's a very subjective form of accounting, if you will, very immersed in the moment, trying to make sense of it, and trying to make sense of it, and trying to make sense of myself within it. And I think that that's the way that I approach even taking on the content in the paintings that I do, but also within the mark making and within the evolution of the marks and the interest in the work. We're really about kind of walking into every contradiction that comes up within my understanding of the world at play. And I feel like in many ways the role of the work and me are to not actually take any kind of objective stance for any of these situations. I feel like it's a constant emerging reality, and I question every gesture that participates within an idea of way of behaving. Like what I, I think it has to really be this constant emergent creative process of how to be an active, creative, alive agent in the world today. Mm-hmm. And how does that happen? And I mean that politically and socially and economically. And how can you constantly be changing and shifting your understanding of what's going on by participating, but also digesting the world differently?
I know that for me, when I first knew of your work before I saw it in Istanbul, and I can speak for a couple other colleagues, that one thing that struck us about your work was that you introduced the idea of social agency as an integral part of a painterly practice at a time when video, new media was emerging at that time as well, where social agency had a more prominent, played a more prominent role. Would you agree with that? Or?
In terms of film and video.
But in a painterly
like
practice.
Able to, in painting, it was harder to.
I think so.
For me, it was always about trying to find a way to make paintings that could be interesting to me, but also the paintings where I was trying to make, like I said, sense of myself. And so I had to find a way to, I was very committed to painting and drawing because it chose me, really. And in a way, it was the contradictions I was interested in, that's the reason I stayed away from anything very figurative or representational. And so I think that a lot of political work was emerging in text-based work, in other forms of performance. You could deal with these political social realities with film, video, and these forms had been happening since the early 90s, the 80s. You had this kind of and 70s. You had
it's like
been
a documentary
going on.
Approach.
Yeah, you had these many ways to deal with social and political desire and issues and. And I was very interested in painting, and because that was, like I said, this form that I was very connected to and that I felt was, the way that I could work. So I had to find a way to do that within painting for me that could work and try and address some of these other issues that I was interested in.
Right.
That were important to me, that are crucial to who I am in a way.
Absolutely. The idea of the third space is often discussed in terms of your work as well. And you've used the word emergent often, and third space is a sort of an emergent space.
Yes.
I would describe it as in that way. And This has become a very important idea in your work over the last 10 years, or is it?
This has really come into the work, and it's actually someone who's here in the audience, Maggie, who came up with this term in a way, when discussing my work with me. She came through a studio visit, and it was this. Her articulation was much more complex in terms of talking about third space, and she had a very specific kind of argument that led to contemporary sublime and some other aspects that she was describing. But for me, what really resonated in just talking with her in the studio was this. These two forces, the architectural and the rational, and the kind of the way of trying to make sense of what was happening in the studio and the world at large, right? These two things at the same time, which is a very Cartesian approach, mm-hmm. and then the organic, intuitive approach to generating the images and generating the painting and kind of following a certain type of intuition and getting lost in making, and that's how the marks generate and become and shift and have changed over the time, and also the structure in the paintings and. So within the combination and collision of these two, there's this other form that has started to really emerge since the erasure, since the Guggenheim paint, since the Venice era, which was really in 2007, the first painting that really that took place in 2006, 2007. So since that time, slowly, this concept has been becoming more and more clear or kind of an emergent part of the work. It has been a big part of the most recent work, I think, even more so. Yeah, so that's the trajectory of that. But I love this idea of the term because it also has a very political kind of orientation as well. You know, when you think of third world or third orientation or third Reich. Or
thirdness.
Thirdness. There's this other form of, it allows for this other possibility, third gender, whatever it is. It's like this. And so, you know, this idea of this other dimension that could exist within this, from the addition of two, but this collision of two where something else is possible.
Right. I know many people are probably thinking or wondering when we're going to talk about Mogamma. So maybe specifically, let's talk about Mogamma, the cycle. I call it a cycle of paintings because I think of it, again, operatically. They were produced as, were they commissioned for Documenta or were they works that you were in the progress of making?
No, they were really made specifically for that context and within the idea of thinking of that that type of context and venue.
And Documenta is an international art exhibition that happens every 5 years in Kassel, Germany, is an exhibition that is characterized by a very rigorous sort of conceptual approach where artists are invited to participate on a platform, a global stage, if you will, to explore issues that are very relevant and to the contemporaneous realities of the day, and also to put artists in context, an historical context, but also one that's contemporaneous. So when I first saw those paintings, I was invited to come visit you and your assistants in your studio in Harlem. And it was this massive wall. You had the four paintings lined up and quite a production. Mm. Can maybe walk us through the sort of process of making them?
There's some images of the production of the paintings that are in this slide presentation that you might have seen people on scissor lifts working on tracing projections of photographs into these paintings. Walk us through.
Well, the paintings are massive. They're very large. Each painting is constructed with different layers of information.
Yeah.
And we begin with a system of lines that really begin to like lay out a formal logic in the paintings.
When I was first invited to Kassel, and Carolyn, the curator, gave me several choices of space, and she was really let me do. You do what you want, and I could make a group of smaller paintings or. But this wall that she had offered me was a wall that faced the big park in Kassel, and there were these trees in this park that are constantly looking in at this wall, and this wall that's constantly looking out at this city, and this park had a very specific role in the city. It was this park of leisure, and it was an enormous park for the scale of the city, and it was really built for the Kaiser, who wanted to use the park for his strolls and leisure. So there was this kind of historic narrative there a little bit, but also Castle is a very politicized, very kind of, was part of the war instrument, Nazi war instrument of Nazi Germany. So it has this other very strong history as well, and that was completely devastated during the war. So you have these layers of history there, and I was interested in this wall that looked out at that in a way. But I didn't want, I had made a large painting that had looked out in the city in New York previously, and I didn't want to do the same kind of thing or treat it the same way, this wall. So I wanted to do, and in these large context things, these big walls can also become background for something else. So that's when I started to really think about metering the wall and breaking it up into these individual experiences. And one of the reasons that I chose this format, the vertical format, and really determine the size of them based on the scale of the space and how I wanted to have this individual local experience with each painting, but then also have the vista of the four. Mm. In the end, I don't think it was as successful. I think they work much more better individually and more in the round than on a wall together.
Right.
But with that in mind, I was working in the studio with this underpainting that somehow all four paintings had an interaction, had this map that sprawled out over all four of them. And then from that, and then once we put the surface on the paintings, we started to put projections in of architectural drawings. I started to work with the first plans I drew into the Mogammas were images of Moscow Square in Addis Ababa, which was important to me and which was played a big role in my own familiar history, but also in the reason that my family ended up leaving Ethiopia and the revolution that took place in Ethiopia in 1974, which we left in 1977 when things really started to get bad. It was a very complex, intense revolution that had many intentions and desires, and it was in the end co-opted by the military, and not just the military, but it was actually very much the country was also played by the as a pawn in the bigger geopolitical system of the Cold War. So it was a casualty of the Cold War, like many countries. And so all of these problematics of that moment were being played out again in a very different way in the world stage now, while I was considering the commission for Castle. So that's the reason for the attention to the public square as a point of departure for the paintings. And decided to examine all these public squares that were where you had historic massive protests. And we tried to be somewhat encyclopedic about getting as many cities that we could that had major protests that were kind of reported on globally, historically as well as now.
Right.
And so that's the paintings architecturally are informed by that information, and then the hand and the gesture, which really each painting has its own structure that participates in the cycle. But they also have an interaction to one another so that you could have a vista. They can jump from one to the next. But they're very much their own individual pieces.
Right, and you've shown them twice together.
Yes.
Once in Documenta in Castle, and then again a year or so ago in London.
Yes.
And the installation in London was different in that the paintings were seen in the round, basically,
yeah.
Rather than seen along one long wall. And how was the experience of the paintings in that context? Did that change the experience of the paintings?
Well, I felt that, I felt it changed them extremely. I think one of the problems I had with the wall is that these paintings really require this confrontation with each one individually and a certain amount of time for these forms to emerge within the painting that are visual experiences, optical experiences, but also, and they happen with each person differently, and they take a certain amount of time for that to happen. That the timing that takes is disencouraged by them being along a wall because you really travel through them and you keep traveling through them. Where that form of making where you travel and you move through, that cinematic way of looking at a painting, can happen when you're really much more trying to decipher something or break it down into parts and then go back into it and have smaller experiences within this larger perspective. But these, I was much more interested in the total experience that you could have by that one painting, and that experience slowly changed the longer you looked at the painting. So I felt that the London installation was much more successful in encouraging that type of looking at the painting.
Yeah.
And again, that was a learning lesson from seeing them on this wall and having worked generally in a way where
the kind of experience I was interested in was much more of getting a local experience by being up close with the painting, and then having a distant experience of the total whole from a distance where you could kind of cinematically travel through the painting. Mm. So it was a shift in the way that I was thinking about seeing and experiencing the work, and then how you can then exhibit it to really encourage that.
And you worked with the architect David Ajay, yes, in London for that installation. What was it like working with an architect? I mean, have you worked with an architect in the past? Or?
Not in the same way. And yeah, it was he was fantastic to work with. He was very open and really came to see me, met with me in London with the, in front of the paintings, and then really went and thought about what I had brought up as what it took place with the paintings and Castle, and what I was not so happy with, but what I wanted to try and encourage. And he was able to really take that, and he built a space that we could travel through. And then through many other adjustments, it was actually interesting because I have a very close friend of mine, Kate, was in the studio, and she was playing with the model that he had sent, and we ended up turning the whole cube at an angle. So, and I told him about that, and we wanted to try that. He was so open to that. He loved it. He was like, that's fantastic. And then we started to move in that direction. So then we opened up the walls, and he adjusted that. But so it was really this collaborative back and forth, and he was fantastic.
Any more collaborations then with architects in the future?
Sure.
Yeah.
Definitely.
This idea for me of all this information in each painting, and I experienced them in London as well, not in the installation, but a similar configuration, was really remarkable seeing them in the round in that way. Because there was, for me, an overwhelming sense of enormity, of information, of detail, of history, of different histories, rather, that comes back to, I think, the idea of the sublime. You mentioned that someone had written about the sublime in terms of your work. But the sublime, for me, meaning this overwhelming forces of history and the that are bearing upon the present that we're unable to really grapple with in a way that's logical. The sublime is a very tricky and very amorphous word, right? I know it's hard to talk about. But in terms of our present situation, being in the present with those paintings is really a powerful moment because you have to really be, you really feel this presentness in the work. That's time-based, I think. You know?
I think that part of the intention of my desire in making is that every day drawing on a piece of paper and making a mark on a piece of paper can actually be an act of dissent. Like, it can be in opposition to something that tells you that the modes of standardized behavior, buy this, shop like this, eat like this, whatever it is. Even when you're buying gas, listen to these stupid commercials. Like, it's this machine that we're constantly up against, or interacting with. Somehow, being able to take this time away from that world every day, go into this space, and be able to create this other thing and make this gesture is not just exciting because something else can happen in there, and that something can be invented in that space, but that action of inventing within this context can actually be an act of dissent. Like, I think that's a very important, potent, powerful gesture in by itself. And so when making work and thinking about all of these larger issues or questions and these kind of contradictions that we face, and the ideas of individual agency and possibility and larger ideas of the machine and how dehumanized so many human beings have become through the world that we live in. Yet this to keep kind of this kind of release and relief of like allowing that to just be what it is and being able to create and make something else possible from that is and that another form can emerge through that, something else can be digested or come out in that process is for me super that's where this kind of hope or excitement is, in the same way that gesture of just putting this mark on a piece of paper can have this potency. This collision of all of this information and the kind of sifting through it to find some form through this like highly pressurized state of all of this information, all of these marks, the scale of this information, that something else can happen, which can be a very kind of, which can have another form possibility is super, I don't know, it has the same, I have the same type of excitement about that as I do about that gesture. So, and it's because of this this possibility of something that is maybe kind of trying to be, that it doesn't have really a lot of space for that form, but it's necessary to who we are.
Do you think this is particularly characteristic of the time now we're living in, the present, given our having to grapple with this media, intensely media-saturated world now and negotiating?
I think that contributes more to it. But I think that if I think about, pre-Civil War times in the United States, and you think about the kind of colonization of this country and the Atlantic slave trade and the dehumanization of what happened in this world through colonization, and you can go through these moments historically that have been really horrific, and yet I think Toni Morrison has this wonderful quote, and I'm going to butcher it. I'm not going to get it exactly right, but talks about how that condition really allowed for the American creative imagination to exist, because you had to imagine, because of the dehumanization. And I'm paraphrasing; I'm not quoting it. Because you had to imagine the not me, the opposite of me, and through that allowed for the space of possible imagination and possible other creative and inventiveness. And so for me, I think that without this kind of drippy desire and humanist kind of efforts and desires, that there's this other, that other possibilities are still going to kind of emanate from within these very kind of oppressive situations, puts into context our moment of oppressive situation in a way, and that there's constantly these different forces at work within that, but that there's always this kind of regeneration of something else that is kind of working in opposition to those forces as well.
Regenerative, yeah. Absolutely. Speaking of painting, let's maybe bring it back to painting for a moment, because I think that you've described yourself as a painter, and painting is very important. And there's a history of painting that is referenced in the works that is I think can be revealing also about or can add to what you've just described in terms of our following the arc of whether it's colonization of political ideas in art history from Russian constructivism to the present. What are in earlier in your work? Who were the artists you were looking at? Who were the artists you were thinking about? I think about Turner when I look at your work.
I like that. He's so lucky. In terms of historic artists, like for me,
anyone.
I think like there were so many different artists who were important to me at different times. Yeah. Alan McCollum was very important to me when I was first painting. Matt Mullican was another important artist. Artists that were building an entire language for a universe that existed on its own, a cosmology. Artists that were committed, that could find this way of kind of young, somebody else maybe at that time would be Matthew Ritchie. Then there were these, there were specific artists that had, that's when I was first starting this work. And at the time, also, there were other artists who were doing that in very, very different ways. Conceptual artists like Gabriel Orozco, whose work and cosmology were kind of evolving with this, and with his writing and this kind of situation. Very, very differently, I think, than artists like Richter or Polka, who were coming from a very different tradition and history that I also was informed by. Then you had other artists that did this, that really impacted me in the way that they thought about and invented ways to be critical of the context within which they were working, but also critical of, but also very kind of incredibly poetic and joyous within what they were doing. Artists like David Hammons or Adrian Piper, who were important to me when I was also younger. So you have this kind of wide breadth of artists that I was looking at and informed by and interested in. And And through the distillation of aspects of different people's practice and approach and ways of approaching and thinking, liberated me and gave me a place to also continue an investigation in. So then now I look at a lot of other artists, from historical artists to, you know, moments of the artists of the present moment.
And the images that are cycling on the screen now are really an archive, or you describe them as sort of an archive of images that inform the paintings that we've been talking about, Mogamma. And other images that you've taken off of the internet, different sources. And
from the internet, from picture collections. A lot of them come from the New York Times and other news sources. Most of them, some of them are historic images that are well-known historic images of, let's say, Potsdamer Platz after the war, or things like that. But generally, the archive has been this, the photo archive that I keep regularly alongside the work has been me grabbing parts of the outside world that grab me, or that are events that are taking place, and somehow keeping them in the studio. And they used to be, when I was younger, all over the walls of the studio, and I was working on the paintings with them. Now I really don't have them everywhere, because I am consuming that information daily. And the information is much more readily available now. I mean, before I was clipping things out of the newspaper. Now everything's available online. So it's a very, very different kind of reality that we're living with within.
Right.
So you can keep a virtual archive very clear, easily. But those images, they're just, they're the world, they're what's taking place.
And do you actually archive them, keep them, files, electronic files?
I used to do that a lot more than now. Now, they tend to be archived on the computer. Like, so I have files with images, so Every image we have of Homs now we have in the computer. Every image of Aleppo before the destruction of Aleppo and post the destruction of Aleppo I have in a file on the computer. Of Damascus and what has been going. So kind of following these events and keeping them in as a photo archive in the computer.
Right.
For ourselves.
Right, right. It's very interesting for people to understand that these points of reference are historical, that they're from different continents, different parts of the world, different world events.
Yeah.
And so that there is, again, this sort of collapse of time that's historical, that speaks to this compression of time in the paintings that I think is very palpable when you're looking at them.
And that it's really, that I think does relate very specifically to also where we are and who we are and how we are and how we can communicate so easily and understand other contexts so easily in the world in a way. We could also get very confused by that and misunderstand because of the same kind of ease of information. But I think that that compression of time and space is a way to locate ourselves really quickly right now within this like long expanse of time and long expanse of the spatial experience and then all social political intentions that are manifested in those, to compress them in this quick moment, replicates this, maybe not replicates, but is like more of a metaphor for this condition that we're currently, I think, very much in, where this past is not escapable. Mm-hmm. It informs every aspect of how we behave. If you look at the current situation right now between the United States and Russia, it's being very informed by a historic narrative between the two countries.
That's exactly what I was trying to get at when I was talking about presentness. Yeah. Presentness, locating oneself in the painting and feeling that it's a very, it's a really palpable time passing, I think, or time that is in the present future in the paintings for me. That's really, anyway, very
cool.
Moving. Yes, very cool. Very cool. We talked about, we looked at your print downstairs as well in the lower level galleries, and we talked briefly about printing and printmaking in terms of your practice as a painter. How do they inform one another? Or?
Yeah, well, the printmaking has grown alongside my painting. I started making prints in graduate school. The program at RISD is a painting printmaking program. So our first year as painters, we were forced into the print studio, and we all complained because
that was not our intention, desire, why we were there. And but it was through actually printmaking and through working with etchings, when I really was trying to make, you have to work on these small copper plates, that I started to actually work on these very small drawings in the etchings. And that's how I came into the early language that I was doing. So it was through this being forced into this practice that I, but it's because of there's a certain kind of experimentalness that can happen with printmaking, and because really, for me, the struggle with the medium and working in copper, etching into copper, working with acid, working with these tools, very different tools, it really made me, in a way, had to rethink everything and how I would make a mark. And all of that, those changes and questions really did end up informing the painting. So my prints have been with me alongside the process for a long time since. And then, and so I work on them sometimes in between projects, and recently for the last 4 years, 5 years, I've been really keeping them working on prints alongside my painting and drawing practice.
I always find it interesting when artists say that printmaking for them is liberating, because I've never made a print, but I always imagine it's really the opposite, because you have to make a matrix and you've got all these different techniques and processes you're working with to produce an image that you have to imagine in advance of its production.
Well, I think, like, if you think about Rembrandt, who would make his own etchings, print them himself, wipe every plate himself, prepare his acid bath. I mean, when you think of an artist like that, I think then you can really appreciate that right at the moment. But the other side of it is that, the way a contemporary printmaker is working is I get the opportunity to work with these incredible artists, other artists, and master printers who can make the copper do anything you want it to do. So it's this collaborative process, much more the way a producer and a musician will work together, a singer and a producer, where they kind of provide all of this material that you can work with, and they can adjust, they can take that sound and just tone it down, make it as quiet as you need it to be, and they can do that with pigment and color, and they can change a dark etching into the lightest gray or the lightest blue or pink, whatever you need it to be. So there's this very free, experimental way to interact with the work that is much. And they'll try things that you'll never have tried, and show you, and you're like, why? but then all of a sudden, something might become interesting within that. So it's really that the collaboration between the master printers, their shops, their technology, and me, and what I'm trying to do, where that freedom exists.
So there's space for intuition.
Yeah. Space for intuition, there's space for playfulness and inventiveness and, collaboration, which always brings something else into the work.
Yeah.
And they've been very informative in changing, making changes in the paintings.
An intuitive sort of approach to painting is something that's also, I think, important to you.
Yeah.
And I think for some people that is a surprise, because they see this system, this architectural system of drawing that lies beneath a more what seems gestural, spontaneous mark making, maybe not spontaneous but gestural, and for some folks that those two sort of systems come from different places, one from a very logical place and the other from a place, another Cartesian dilemma I don't mean to throw out there, but I get a sense that the architectural drawings in the paintings are very much intuitive in terms of the juxtapositions, how they create almost like a matrix in the painting.
They're very, the only planned elements is the information that's going to go into the paintings. And I don't even use all of that information. Yeah. I use a very small portion of it. So the idea of the conceptual idea of using this type of information, like this public square for the site of a painting or for the site of the actions in the painting. And I think of them socially that way, the paintings, as actually being these spaces or kind of being these containers and vessels for these spaces as well as these paintings. So the architectural drawing, the elements, each architectural photograph that's then projected into the painting is done one at a time. So one building at a time or one photograph at a time. And that montage, that layered montage collaging aspect is very driven by my own intuitive kind of desire of where I want to put something in the structure that's emerging and responding to that. And that's not, it's only afterwards that I'll try and make sense of what I've done by trying to make sense of why is this structure emerging in this painting, whereas in this panel, this other form is really emerging. Why is this painting operating in this way? And then I try and make sense of that
after the process of making. But I don't try to make from that place ever. And every time I've tried to make from a place of preconditioned, determined, rational perspective, I've killed. And I mean, it's been awful. So for me, that's not a way that I can work. Most of my interesting decisions and new forms and evolutions in the work come from following this intuitive form of knowledge. A very good friend who's an artist as well, he was writing about his practice, and he said he likes to try and speak before he thinks. And it's, in this way, it's symptomatic of the of what is inside of him, but the world around, the collages he makes. And I found that resonated so well with me, like this effort to let it happen before you can actually know what it is. And in that, there's a new form of knowledge that you can access in a way within yourself.
It's beautiful. I think there probably are many students in the audience who are totally geeking out that you're here, for one thing, but also who are struggling through, you know, grad school, even undergraduate school, and, you know, maybe you get this question sometimes, maybe not, but have any advice for young artists? I mean, you were working, you grew up in Michigan, you were working outside of a center, outside of a metropolitan center, and evolving as an artist, and your thought processes were evolving. How do we give some hope and encouragement?
There's really, you know, the desire to make comes from a very deep place in all of us, whoever wants to make. Whatever type of maker you are, if you're a poet, if you're a writer, if you're an architect, musician, dancer, painter, you have these different ways of approaching. You have this desire, and it's almost this necessity to do this, to make in a way. And I think that there's a lot of, especially in the interconnected kind of world that we're in, where you have social media playing such a role in terms of how you can actually participate and put your, that one side of, and this is coming from talking to a lot of these younger artists that I work with in my studio and other artists, there's this pressure to try and have a career and have this other form, have your work exist in the world already before the actual work has even been made, before deep questions and decisions and desire and understanding of who you are as an artist and what your intention is and how you want to make and why that is important and where that drive comes from within you. Those are the burning, deep impulses. And so to really understand those and nurture those, I think, is more important than anything else. And the form of how that will participate in the world will invent itself, kind of spontaneously come clear from within the making of the work and from that dedication and to that process to really. So I think that you have to be very careful in terms of how you approach thinking around work, because so many worlds, whether it's the world of sound, music, the recording industry, the film industry, the art world, is being completely kind of co-opted by other forces and intentions and desires. And I think it's very important to really, you know, you see this in publishing with writers, you see it in every form of making. And I think it's just important to find a way to follow what's really important in terms of inventing and being able to be creative and have a creative life.
Yeah, there's this really accelerated pace that I think it can be detrimental, that it seems to continue to accelerate year after year, and it always seems sort of career-oriented rather than finding that space or finding yourself, and which
the economy and the market determine so much in terms of our even evolution of democracy and understanding of who we are as a collective, and it's very difficult, I think, as a creative person to try and, you know, that part of the challenge is to really push these boundaries and ask different questions and not follow a form of or way of making an approach towards that. It's really about questioning those preconditions in a way. Questioning, right. You know, really, and having fun, enjoy, like playing with it. That's what I mean, not enjoying, but play. There's this element of play and inventiveness and that should participates in that, as well as, I think, you know, social, political realities that you live within.
Yeah, and part of your, which is part of the many artists' intention, yeah. I mean, to deal with, to grapple with and to contend with those realities in the work, as well as ideas about pleasure and visual pleasure, joy. Anyway, I think that's really useful for students to hear because there's such pressure right now, I think, like there, I'm sure, was when you were a student, but it seems very, very much amplified today, these pressures from outside, winds that are blowing people one way or another are influencing decision-making, so.
And there are two sides to that. People are using those forms of social media to really create new forms of making, which are fantastic and really interesting. And then also using those forms as venues for expression, which is also really interesting. So there are different benefits and costs and challenges.
Or dissension. I mean, yeah. Arab Spring was a case in point where Twitter and social media was really something that
Facebook.
And Facebook, that's it. Yeah.
Played a role, but a small role. I mean, I think in most of the countries, it played a big role in one way, but it's only 1-2% people who really had access to those forms. So, from my understanding, but they were hugely important as well.
Right. I think we have are going to take some questions from the audience, and I don't know how we're going to do it. But if Aaron will come up and instruct us. There she comes. Sorry? Okay, yeah. It's hard to see because the lights are really bright. But if people can raise their hands, Aaron in the row there has a microphone, and we'll take some questions. So I have a question right there in the center. Is Aaron? Yes. Oh, sorry.
Hi, I have a question. Since you mentioned the desire several times, I think I guess you're using the situationist international term, desire. Could you tell us about the relationship between desire and your painting, the relationship?
When I use the word desire, I mean, the situation is maybe dealt with this also similarly, but also differently. But I'm thinking a lot of social desire and ideas, like, in a way, ideals that we have on ideas of space, but and history and politics, but also in terms of social behavior and what we can achieve by behaving a particular way. And that alongside that desire, there tends to be a very dogmatic, dictatorial kind of way coupling. The kind of emerges from within that. And we've seen that happen in historic revolutions, but we've seen that also happen within culture. And, Stuart Hall, who just passed, there's a legendary figure in thinking from a radical perspective, but in a way that was constantly readjusting and reanalyzing, re-questioning the moments, and not allowing this desire of change and desire of dissent to actually consume itself in a way, or actually become something that has its own fanaticism behind it. And so those are that's how, I mean, I'm using the word in that way. But also, I'm interested in, formally, in also the desire behind this kind of form of making, and what is the experience of, like, looking at a work of art, and especially what is the experience of looking at a painting? And that's from somebody who's making paintings, but also from somebody who's looked at a lot of paintings in my life and I get a lot out of looking at paintings and have for a long time. So whether it's Poussin, Caravaggio, Rembrandt, you know, to contemporary paintings that I'm looking at, what projection am I putting on those paintings, and what desire do I have? And how can I play with that and question that and ask questions about that?
Mm-hmm. Hi, I was just wondering, when you were in school, if you had a difficult time staying true to your process as an artist, or if your process was still more in the developmental phase and that was of less concern to you.
Yeah, I mean, graduate school really is about taking apart, making questions and trying to make sense of who you are. And I had really an incredible group of teachers and a few teachers in particular that were really important to me and who really helped me get to a place of allowing this language to emerge in my work. So my work in graduate school was really about coming into this language, and then this language has been an emergent evolutionary kind of growing process since then.
I was interested in your paintings that deal with a specific place, like the public square or a series of public squares. Is it important for you to go and actually visit the sites, or is it more, I know you mentioned a virtual archive, is it more kind of mediated by this the variety of media that we get here?
That's an interesting question, because I've done paintings like this from both perspectives. Istanbul, the painting that is at the Modern in New York, that painting was informed by going to Istanbul, seeing the city, experiencing the city, photographing the city, then going back to New York and making the painting, and then taking the painting back to Istanbul. It was the first time I actually tried to deal with a historic portrait of a city. Since then, there have been some other paintings that have been based in specific cities, Berlin, New York City, Cairo, Tahrir Square, and then paintings like this that are kind of embedded in a time, the Stadia paintings, which were about, you know, looking at stadiums or expos, and then these paintings of Mogamma's, which is the public square. I think that with this experience, there, I had not been to a lot of these cities, and in the paintings I did in 2007, 2008, 2009, those were very. I was looking at places like Iraq and Afghanistan, where we were engaged in, you know, horrific conflicts and there, and devastating these places in a way. And I was really interested in trying to make sense of that as an American citizen, as someone responsible for these actions that were taking place in these countries. And those weren't places that I could travel to and I had not been to. So all of that information was very much about consuming a place or making sense of a place through mediated information, which is an interesting, by itself, approach towards something. But then working on Tahrir Square, I had been to Cairo. I was there before. I'd been there several times. I was there before the revolution, and then there a year after the revolution, just shortly after Morsi was like the first newly elected president. So I was able to kind of, and it was the most uncanny experience to have made this painting that looked at the city in such detail, and then to go back to that city and actually experience that city again through this very different lens of having made the painting. So I think, you know, I work with both in both ways, and it really depends on the place.
Question here. Oh. Hi. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit about your relationship with your assistants as it relates to gesture, something that you spoke about a lot, both on a practical level of their own mark making and also more conceptually as a collective group gesturing together.
It's nice. Important question. The team that I work with are some of them have been with me for a very long time and know my practice very well. We've evolved in relationships. This is like a collaborative process. Even the surface person that I work with, she's been with me a very long time. The chief studio production kind of manager, maker, he's an incredible artist on his own and on his own right, and he is the one that really coordinates all the architectural drawing for me and with my team, with the others. Sometimes that team grows and is a large number, like when I was working on mural in Berlin, we had at one point there was 30 of us working in the studio, to the point where, like right now, where there's the three of my three core people, myself, and then three part-time assistants and one full-time, who really are working on very specific roles in the painting. None of them work on the gestural drawing and the paintings. They only translate photographs or architectural stuff. They work on the surface painting. Sometimes one of them, he's an incredible also graffiti artist, and he's very, very good with spray painting. I'm trying to get this kind of atmospheric aspect happening in the paintings, and he's really working on trying to develop that with me. So there are these ways that we collaborate to try and find a language together. There's a way, like, in first working with an assist with working with people, it was this giving up of a certain type of agency of your own in a way. And so I had to, in the early days, had to find a form for doing that. And in a way, I let the work kind of invent a new way to work to be able to make this other language and tool, how to utilize it. And so some of these people can draw in ways that I could never draw on my own. And they're incredibly talented individuals and artists. And we have very intimate relationships. I mean, we have a kitchen in the studio. People can eat on their own. Some days we cook together. Some days one person cooks for everyone for lunch one day out of the week if they want to. Nothing's really imposed. There's a very cohesive dynamic that takes place, but there are also very individual practices, and everyone can come in and get in their headphone space. I tend to work in a very different space than them. I don't tend to work with them. I tend to kind of work with them at one point in the day, and then I tend to go and do my own work, and I isolate myself from them in that practice with curtains because I need my own individual space for the type of work I'm doing, which is usually the gestural mark making in this form of drawing.
And isn't the word Mogamma in Arabic, does that mean collective?
Yes, and I think the source is a collective institution. For religious institution, where my understanding is it was historically a type of structure that housed a synagogue, a mosque, and a church.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah, which is, in that sense, collective. And in that sense, so that to me was a very interesting kind of word. And I think that's the reason that the building was titled that. So the painting came from that word, Mogamma.
And I think I failed to mention the title of the painting. Mogamma refers to the public building on Tahrir Square.
Yes.
The Mogamma, which is the official government building. Administrative building.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is, I think, the only building, if I'm correct, that was really, there's actually another one or two, but this one was one of the big, most defining buildings of when they were planning the whole structure of building Tahrir Square, when it evolved past the barracks, the British barracks, the Egyptian Museum, and what it evolved into.
Mm. Well, where are you, Aaron? Do we have time for one more?
We can take one more if you.
I see Jordan right there.
What I was going to ask is, hello, I'm Jordan. First, thank you for coming tonight. Like, I really appreciate that you came by. So what I experienced with your painting was, like, from tonight, what I wanted to ask is, like, pretty much subculture. It's like bringing everyone together and bringing that unity from different mediums to different markets, different aspects, different textures, different colors. How is that? Like, because that pretty much brings us to new emergence, I guess my question would be, is, like, we always talk about the past, and like I'm more interested in where you're going next. So it's like, how is that combining now with that voice of using certain cityscapes or using certain colors or using the different layouts, going into printmaking, doing shows on different mediums? Like, how do we now, like, because this brought us all together, I guess, for this conversation in a sense. So let's talk about, like, what's next.
Good question. I'm working on new paintings that don't have very much architectural drawing in them, or they don't have any architectural drawing in them. The entire space is constructed out of the marks, and I don't know. They haven't resolved enough for me to really have the language to actually talk about them here, and they're still really much in the process of emerging and being made. And so, but I'm interested in them, and I'm very excited by them because they don't have the armature of the city, but somehow the city is very much embedded in there. And these ideas that I've been interested in somehow come through in these paintings, even though these paintings also look like virtual letter. They look like kind of ancient walls to you know different types of writing to different types of urban space, but also very kind of natural, kind of overgrown Gondwana land kind of landscape. And so you have these very different resonances coming out of these paintings, and I'm interested in those collisions and what's happening that can happen from within this space. This very, it's a gray paint, gray surface, and then black ink on this gray surface, and layers of sanding that and building that up, and something. So that's what I'm working on now.
Well, Julie, I think we've come to the end of our program, but I wanted to thank you for painting for us a truly awe-inspiring, thought-provoking, compelling, great, I was going to say masterwork, but I don't like, everyone who knows me knows I hate the word masterwork, but a masterpiece truly, and it's something that I know we have people coming back to the museum over and again to see and spend time with, as is required to really experience a painting. Every time you come, you experience something new in the work, and also for work that asks us to confront our own responsibility in terms of the present that we're all sharing. So thank you for that, and thank you all for coming, and please join us over across the piazza for a visit to the gallery. So thank you very much for coming.